You see, our dear friend Sasha Dees is here. Give her a roll tide welcome. Thank you, guys. Don't forget, your final reflection is due tomorrow. You can start with what I've offered here, which has disappeared, and flesh out. But I really do need to hear where you are with race and music and the word UK, just to see where we started and where we ended. And if we're all here today, I want to make sure we get a where we ended or where we are now with Sasha in our photograph. But real quick, how do y'all feel in this heat?
Tired,
definitely. Is it awful?
I want to be cold.
I know. It's awful. But make sure you stay hydrated. Yeah, right? At least we got that smile. You got your water. You gonna hang in there? Gabriel's smile is there. Okay. All right, you guys. So final journal is tomorrow. This is just crazy. Having a hard time with this thing today. There we are. And then we have next week our friend Ken is here. He lived in Neaston, which is where 26A is set. I know you guys are tired. Just pull what you can out of 26A and Warren Ellis. Like right now, bite-sized pieces are enough to do the work before you for that very short reflection. Do not overwhelm yourselves. We've talked enough that you guys should be picking up on what's at stake. Yes?
So when you say that this last, so you're saying the last essay is shorter, do you have like a certain length that you want? Because I know we've just been kind of writing how much we think.
Right, just get it out. Like, I noticed that you guys are staying the entire time writing, and I never expected that. and that's fine. You're producing good work. It's fine. But just know that, so say if you are turning in two to three or three to four pages, think more about one to two on Monday, because you're going to realize you don't have enough time anyway. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because, you know, Ken is going to be here. Could someone kindly move that curtain so we get a little darker in here? He's a funny a funny chap. If he ends up saying a lot of like Britishisms, be prepared to laugh because it'll just come out of his mouth. Like those words like bloke and blimey. And if you don't understand him, sometimes you may have to just raise your hand and say, Mr. Ken, can you slow it down a bit? Because he is like born and raised in England, okay? So I am not as tired as I was yesterday, but I am tired. And I feel your fatigue too. We're gonna push through. And I think a good part of tomorrow we're gonna be outside just breathing, okay? Yes. All right. So Sasha, again, Dees is here. Sasha, you said you were born in the Netherlands, but raised in Belgium.
No, it's in the Netherlands, but the Netherlands have, there's a small piece in the south that is connected to Belgium, and you can actually enter the rest of Holland with a ferry, or you have to drive over Belgium to go to the rest of Holland. And now there is a tunnel, but when I grew up, it was like that. So it felt like I lived in Belgium, because you always had to go there to even get to the rest of the country, which you never did because you got stuck in Antwerp or something, which was already a nice city to be in.
Yeah.
So that's basically what I grew up on a farm. It was really the countryside. I guess like, you know, the south of Holland as you are in the south of the U.S. So,
Lovely. That's lovely. I wanted to mention Belgium because you guys will be attentive because we're crunched right now for time. To Nina Simone's life, and she's one of many African Americans who end up on this side of the pond. Not unlike Marvin Gaye, who Sasha met when she was a young woman, I think.
I was a teenager, still in high school. I think I was like 14 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And, I was a little bit rebellious, so I would like climb out of my...
Can you hear her?
Go out to go clubbing in Antwerp, which he was doing sexual healing at the time and living in Belgium, so he would go club there as well. And so that's where I met him a couple of times, which,
right,
you know, at the time felt like organic, and then later on you're like, oh wow.
Yeah. So she understands, and we'll definitely talk about it today, the problems that some people we might call marginalized, even the most famous, have, that forces them, as true with the West Indians, to move somewhere else. And so Marvin Gaye and Nina Simone fit into that story. They end up in Belgium. Chaka Khan lives now in England, and we could go on and on. Langston Hughes spent some time on this side of the pond, Richard Wright, James Baldwin. But I wanted to quickly just give you some idea of just the breadth of her life, and then we're going to get into the book and all sorts of things. When she leaves us, and this is the kind of person that Sasha is, she goes, so when I leave you guys, I'm going to go to London, I'm going to go hang out with, and she'll say someone's name, and you go, who? And it turns out that it's someone else who is in the arts, and she's a part of that world, and yet she's so down to earth. So I really hope you guys, like, embrace this moment, because this is a person, if I may say as much, who's dedicated her entire adult life to figuring it out, and she figured out that she wanted to facilitate, give back, I mean, through the arts.
Mm-hmm. I just liked, originally, like, I was just a curious guy, you know, like, I read books, I would always, like, ask questions on, like, this why kid, and growing up in the countryside, you know, there's not that much to do, and I was just curious, so I thought I need something to do that I can travel, and, you know, meet all these things that I read about in books, and make, form my own opinion around it, so that's basically what inspired what I do. So then first people would tell me, like, oh, well, if you want to travel, you need to become a diplomat, and I'm not very diplomatic, so that was not going to happen. But then I was always this organized friend, and then all the friends that would do creative things, I would just organize things around it. So it organically became that, and I liked arts, like art, dance, theater, writing, all of that. So with musicians, and musicians really became the first step to do that, because it was sort of, I would find a festival somewhere and say, if I get you to go there, then I get to go too, right? And they were like, of course, because we want to go there, we have no idea how, so if you figure that out. And that's kind of how that started. It was really random. I found a Jamaican jazz festival, and I had a Surinamese jazz band with friends, and I just managed to get them invited, and then I found out this little travel grant, and we all got to go to Jamaica, which is basically how my career started in this. And then the musicians started making music for theater, and I met all these people, and I mean, we were young, right? I mean, I'm talking your age, basically. So, you know, I thought, okay, I'll start organizing around the people that want to do performing arts, and then I would talk to a theater.
Can I play a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
So this band, she literally traveled with them. And just to give you, I'm not giving you big bio, because
this is like 97.
Yeah, Sasha and I are of the age where you just kind of deal with how old we are. Right?
I'm 32, and I'm sticking to it.
Yeah, right? So just very quickly, we're going to go back up to the New York part, mm-hmm. but just know that when she mentioned the band is from Surin.
Well, they're in Holland, but they're of Surinamese descent, and so in Holland.
On the continent.
Yeah.
Okay, let's just listen.
So this
incredible 80-foot-long light shot that turns any light into a samurai sword for your picture.
Well.
this very Caribbean kind of feel to it.
Yeah, it's like a fusion of jazz and then sort of used typical Surinamese sounds or instruments and rhythms in it. And so they're still around. And I traveled both with this, so there's the big band and there's a small version of Southern musicians, and I traveled with both to the States and the university tours there, and in Jamaica and Suriname. So it's like me and 25 guys on tour, which was quite a trip.
So can we use that to just segue for a second to very quickly how we met? 20 some years ago, who's only 20? Who's less than 20? Gabriel, oh my God. So before Gabriel was on this planet, I met Sasha in New York City via Cheryl Huggins, a mutual friend who was my initial boss, if you will. We both worked for one of the many dot-coms that went under at the turn of the century. Our dot-com was founded by a film producer. I think he did the first House Party movie. And they were, as I told Sasha, ridiculously crazy when it came to money. We would do things like rent Ellis Island to have a party. Like, isn't that just dumb? Like, you're going to go belly up. But long story short, it ended up not being smart, and we went under. But it would be things like, we're on this island, and Britney Spears is coming, and I tell Cheryl, who's our mutual friend, I don't like islands, I'm having a panic attack. You know, I like big islands, I don't like small islands. I'm gonna go back to Manhattan, and she's like, but Britney is coming, I don't care. So it was that kind of thing. We met through Cheryl and Joel Dreyfus, a Haitian journalist.
Yeah.
And how did we find each other again, which I totally forgot. She just told me last night.
So she left New York, and then I think—
Become academic.
Over 10 years later, 15 years later, I think, just before I left, I think around when I left for the Caribbean, I'm in Los Angeles, and there's an animator, and I'm in his house. He's a big collector, so he's showing me all his artwork, and at some point, I'm like, oh, is that Sharony? So that, and he's like, I don't know, I got this as a gift from New Orleans, and I actually don't know who the artist is. And I remembered she had done a book where like a painting like the one I was seeing was on the cover. So I said, I think this is Sharon Green. But then he's like, can you hook me up? I'm like, I need to go find her. I haven't seen her in like 10 years, I guess. But I'll go figure out where she is. So I find her again. I'm like, I think I'm seeing your painting. This is yours, right?
Did you find me on Facebook or Instagram?
I think I was Googling and Facebook and Instagram and so social media. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what social media is good for, all that you find all these people again. So I'm like, look what I found. I found your painting, I think.
Right.
Like, yeah, it's mine. And then she ended up working with the filmmaker in Los Angeles, right?
Yeah, he helped me do some stuff to finish the jazz documentary. Yeah. And again, this is the kind of circle she's in, but what's really cool about her is no matter how many people she names whose names you're going to see on Wikipedia, she's still just Sasha. And I want to delve into that Sasha with you guys today because she's got a lot to share with us about, I think, some of the things we've been addressing, the complexities of empire, race, bringing in culture and music and things like that. As you know, she wrote this book that you guys all have access to. I hope that you were able to read a little bit of it. Just show of hands. It's okay if you say Dr. Green is, you know, it's been like crunch time. I had the Solange book, but who did pick this up? PDF. Oh, a few hands. Yeah. Okay. So you see, if you can just think about why Solange matters. The narrator, Stephanie Phillips, is of West Indian descent. She's playing punk music. Solange is, you know, Daddy Alabama, Mama Louisiana, Creole, back to the Caribbean. We got the Caribbean, you guys, I don't know if you're picking up on it. Not even the United States. The Caribbean is ground zero for a lot of what we've been doing for the last 3 weeks. And there may be reasons for it that are pretty obvious. I mean, Columbus thought he was in some outlying island in the East Indies, and it turns out he's in a place we decide is a new world. But what we want to do with Sasha's recent 2 years in the Caribbean is to sort through the complexities. Yesterday I showed you images of some of the artwork in this book, how people, and not just marginalized people who are Black, but islanders, how they see themselves as opposed to how they're often narrated by others. You saw those really disturbing images via the link to the, I guess it's the University of Cologne, but it's you get it through the Bodleian. And I think we need to pay attention to how we narrate ourselves, we meaning folks on the bottom. And by the way, sometimes you might be the folks on the bottom. It's not just a race thing. It might just be that, who knows, the way our world is going right now, a lot of people don't like Americans, but we're still, like, you know, powerful country. But think about how power is always being negotiated. I can't say that enough. As an antebellum scholar, I saw even the most prominent antebellum Southern planters constantly being challenged. This morning, and we didn't even know we're going to go in this direction, I asked Sasha what her favorite island was. When she was traveling for 2 years documenting, did you ever tell me?
No, because I think it's also, I don't have a favorite island in that sense, because they're so different. So, you know, all of them have something why you wanna be on that specific island. I like, for instance, Dominican Republic, because it's just, it's large, you know, there's 12 million people, like Santo Domingo is a huge city, 3 million people. I mean, that's something else than Cayman Island, 40,000 people. I mean, that's an entirely different dynamic. So there is no one favorite, I guess. I find that very difficult. Like, why do we need to choose always one thing? You know? I mean, no, I just don't want to. I'm refusing.
Good. And you also refuse to be the white lady on the beach. Tell us what you meant by that in your book.
It's so I've been working in the Caribbean and with people from the Caribbean for a long time, and it's people joke, you know, there's always the talk, oh, is there any artist there? I never, you know, never found people, or, and then, you know, like people come by for, they go to an island for 3 weeks for work, but end up meeting 6 artists that already everybody knows, and then end up 2 weeks on the beach. That's sort of the perception of the people on the islands, like, yeah, people come by, but they really are not really interested in getting to know us. So I was so aware of that, that that's always what has been said. And since the 2 year travel, you know, everybody was very generous. I could stay everywhere, I was invited everywhere. So I really wanted to be sensitive to this thing. So I ended up not going to the beach at all because I was too afraid that, you know, like people would say, you see, she's on the beach too, yet another white European woman, you know. So, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
It was a little ridiculous.
But it's almost hard to resist because yesterday we were very hot and some of you went to the river. I heard it was kind of nice, not very nice, but it's, you know, why not go somewhere where there's water when we're hot? The islands are hot. Even when I was in Plymouth, I go to Cornwall, and I just happen to be the Black American on the beach. I don't want to be on the beach.
But it also feeds into the perception we have of each other. Like, so there, of course, there are also other people there that don't do it in that way. But it becomes this thing, and then this general thing that everybody then keeps referring to. And, you know, I might have been on the beach one time, but if there's a picture of it, then all of a sudden I become a person doing that, only that too, whereas I spent 2 years there and I went to the beach once, but that's what sticks. Mm-hmm. And we all do that in a way, right? I mean, and they do that too, like, you know.
Can we go to this image? So this morning I said, oh, Janet Jackson's Demita Joe Island has an interlude where she does the favorite bit. And I'm still trying to figure out why, because I love Janet and all her complexity, that interlude was important. So I'm gonna play it for the students and I want you to tell them what you told me. I hope I have it up. If not, I'll call it up. What did you tell me interlude. Hold on, we're gonna play it first and then you tell me. Janet Jackson. And this, you guys, I'm sharing it with you because I want you to see the complexities of empire. The complexities of empire. She doesn't want to be the white lady on the beach. What's going on with Janet?
The island. Anguilla, that's my favorite. I love the island. That's my escapism. They relax me. That ocean, the weather. I love humidity. I love the sand. I love the palm trees. I love curling up in a good book and relaxing right by the ocean with my baby.
Well, what did you say to me when I said, oh, Aunt Janet likes Anguilla. You went to Anguilla. What was Anguilla like? Tell me the first thing you said.
It's an island with obnoxious rich American people.
Did you guys hear that? What does that mean?
Well, I mean, there's some smaller islands, and Europeans, you know. Let me not be offensive to Americans only, but... The smaller islands, some of them all need tourism, and some of them decided it's better instead of the overwhelming amount of people coming, like to focus on richer people, so get in the money, but like have fewer people destroy your island, really. But when I went to Anguilla, which was actually the same in St. Martin, there are these areas that are totally being bought by rich people. And then the hurricane was just there. So it was, Anguilla was one of the islands that was like totally devastated, really. It was sort of gone. So I went and like most of the hotels were still closed or, you know, if they were still standing, and a lot of the houses of the rich people too, because, you know, I mean, they just don't take in account there's every 10 years there's going to be a hurricane 5 destroying everything. So they are like, I want this glass house on top of a cliff. And then, of course, it's shattered because it's a hurricane 5.
Mm-hmm.
And then what is difficult is that, you know, like it's easy when you have all that money. You're like, oh, you know, now my house gone. Well, I'll just take in the insurance money. And I'll just, well, you know, we've been there for 3 years. Let's just find another island and use the insurance money and rebuild somewhere else so we can go on vacation there for a week.
Okay.
For the next 3 years. And that is sort of really what happens a lot there too. And you realize like how fragile things are and how easy it is if you have like a lot of money to just sort of go places, own places, leave places, and not to think about what's left behind. I mean, it's an island with people living there, and you just sort of, you know, breeze through it.
Mm-hmm. Can we go back to Janet for a second? And I'm going to make it even more complicated. So she's a part of the Motown narrative because she is the baby sister of the Jackson 5, Motown, Berry Gordy, black music, ties to the moans of enslaved people. She's now, as you say, rich, probably not an obnoxious American because she tries to be aware, but still, she is a visitor. What do we make of her being in a video, not unlike many stars, where island people appear to be props?
Yeah.
Appear to be props. And with this particular one, she actually uses or invites someone with island ties to actually rap on the video. What do we make? Let's just take a look at it for a bit. Got the cowrie shells, right? And she's not the only one. Even Beyonce has been criticized for going to the continent and using impoverished people as a backdrop. how do we so easily consume it? I'm not saying, I mean, not indicting us in this room, but how has this been naturalized? This is a recent video.
It's in Brooklyn, no?
It's in Brooklyn, and that's kind of what I wanted you to get at. It's almost portable. Because impressed people must move often, right? But we are always sailing back to our beginnings. But empires all up and through that. Yeah. But what do we do when a wealthy Black American woman, I mean, her dad was working in steel mills. Do we forget that past? And then there may not be any answers, but I'm just complicating what you're saying.
Well, it is difficult.
And then thank you for the Brooklyn, yeah? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so I would like to back up a bit, go to your book now. Again, the students have seen your wonderful, you know, attempt to make this real. That folks in what we call the global South have their own vocabulary and vision of who they are. Did you pick up on suffering or triumph or both being a part of the narratives unveiling themselves in these images, not just these, but others, over your 2 years?
I think a big difference between the artist in the Caribbean itself and in the diaspora is that suffering and identity thing. So, you know, for instance, all the diaspora artists, sort of their work and their conversation is a lot about wanting to be seen in the place they are now. So in your case, America, or, you know, with us in Europe. And that, of course, is not at all an issue when you're in the Caribbean because you have your own territory, which yours. So that is a very different discussion. The same is with, you know, multiculturalism, diversity, inclusivity. That's sort of a given in the region. And now all of a sudden it's being, you know, our problem with it is being imported to it, whereas they're like, but wait, that was what we were anyway, because that's what you created 500 years ago already. We've been here, like, this diversity is what we are. So that's very different to the whole idea. I mean, Caribbean artists are not all Black. I mean, they're mixed, and they're white, and they're Asian.
Do they even use the word white and Black? What all do they use? There's so many categories, if you can share that with them.
Or they don't.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
I am Bahamian. I am Jamaican. I am mountain girl.
It's, again, I think, a discussion, a whole conversation that we have, and we construct it, but it's not necessarily there for them. You know, now all of a sudden they have to talk about that. And it's interesting because it's almost like there was this conference by Deb Willis, and sort of talking about, well, you need to know your history, etc. But that's a very American thing, and it's different. The history in the Caribbean is, there's also the transatlantic slave trade, but that's a different history than in America, and a different history than now diaspora people in Europe. I mean, there is differences, and there should be more nuanced in that way. So there is that conversation also that they want to not get into, like, why do we all of a sudden need to be part of this conversation that happens in Europe or in America.
Mm-hmm. Why do you think they resist?
Because, you know, they are who they are.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, it's like, I want you to see me and where I am.
Right.
Like, how we all want that, really.
I think I was sharing with at least one student here how I've been Black all my life, but I never had to be Black until I got to Alabama.
Yeah.
And I sometimes I blame Alabama and in the university, but I think it's not the Alabama, it's not the university, it's where we are as a society, that you have to talk about diversity and multiculturalism and all this stuff, but then you ask certain people to participate in this event or talk about this, and it was just like, when I wake up in the morning, I don't go, oh, I'm black. I've been black all my life. Like, if it's new to you or if it's good for you, you need to compensate me for the emotional trauma that I have to engage in to go down this road. And I don't think that administrators and larger audiences know. These people are saying, why do I have to be part of this?
Yeah.
Because
does that mean?
Exactly.
You're noticing I'm black, yeah, so,
and what?
Does that,
what I'm
does
just that Sharony. Or they're just, you know, Bill, Bob, yeah, whatever, yeah.
It makes sense to sort of take into account, oh, okay, so I'm from Holland, you're from Alabama, what are the differences? You know, talk about it in that way. What do you bring? What is different?
Mm-hmm.
And be interested in that.
What's this happening there?
This is St. Martin. It's a photographer that did the whole series just after the hurricane. So that's that. Seeing
beautiful
the beauty
image
in something horrible, I suppose.
It's not something.
So there is a lot of work being made about climate and, you know, obviously, and the influence of what we do in the north, and then what is the consequences for the islands.
We're fidgeting partly because it's hot, not because we're not listening to you. So I want us to just take a deep breath and acknowledge that. We need to be real with how we feel right now, right? I think we could step outside if you guys want, to just really breathe and honor this moment. Do y'all know that we leave a week from today, right? Eleonora is good at helping Dr. Green stay in the now. But I'm still thinking about what's ahead. What I'd like to do is, if we could, I don't know, you guys know more about this pond area than I do. I don't want us to necessarily sit in the grass because we have allergies, but I want us to keep talking to Sasha, and I want to segue into some of you asking her questions. But not before I ask her one other thing I think is pertinent to get back to the book. What do you think of this Solange, Why Solange Matters book? What did you tell me last night? I said, what do you think of this book? What did you say to me?
Well, it's...
I'm going to just... It's pointed. Sorry.
I like Solange music and, you know, like following her career. But what I noticed in Holland is with my black girlfriends, that it was so particularly for them, you know, like there was so much in there that was specifically their story. I felt like, yeah, I like the music, but it's also something that she, I think she made for black women, which is fine. You know, I mean, I thought it was great that they felt seen and that conversation, but then again, you know, I am a white European, so a lot of the things don't, you know, they're not for me. I mean, you know, I never say don't touch my hair, although all my friends, you know, over the years have said that.
Why do they say don't touch my hair?
I recognize that.
Why do they say don't touch my hair?
You know, like how people sort of, there's all this, you know, they wear all the different hairstyles, and then people were like, oh, you know, I mean, it's like strangers come up to you at the street, sort of. I mean, you know, who does that? but they do, you know, and then you're like, I mean, I've been walking like, hello, I mean, you know, do you even know her? So, like, yeah.
Anyone in here ever dyed their hair another color? Did anyone come up and touch your hair?
No.
I've had people come up and touch my hair since I was a child.
Yeah?
What did you, how did you feel?
So it was usually older ladies, or like, a lot of the times it would be women like our age when I was young who were like, I want my hair this color. And like, that's complimentary, but I'm 7 years old, and in a supermarket, and I can't find my mother. Stop touching me. That happened a lot. When I went to France, actually, I was very young, and my little sister also has red hair, but my older sister has dark hair, and they would start speaking to my older sister in French, and then they would just start going, hello, your hair is very beautiful, and, like, grab it. So,
Who does that?
Yeah.
So you're saying essentially that some of the women you roll with, not unlike Stephanie, who's the author of this book, and with Big Joni, they're identifying with Solange, essentially saying, I want to reclaim my body. I don't want to be objectified by
so
you.
That I thought was interesting of the book. It was so much about the writer. It was really almost more her story.
Yeah. So, yeah. Stephanie is an Afro-Briton, ties to West Indies, but she's feeling Solange wanting to reclaim her, you know, her blackness, her beauty. And it's real. It's real. By the way, I'm going to give y'all Sasha's playlist. I asked her for music that she wanted to hear walking in, and she did. I'm going to give you the links. This is really cool stuff. I want to go back to Marvin Gaye and Belgium and safety for the black body. Heading to Europe, of all places.
To say that we didn't know how long.
Says, well, we're going down to the pub. We're just going to sit and communicate.
Where are you going from, Paraguay?
Oh, yeah.
Paraguay.
You know, when they came, he liked it, Martin. He was surprised, you know. Some people cared for him.
Sexually, as you know, so.
Tonight, I'm so proud to have the greatest singer in the world in the auditorium tonight. It's Marvin Gaye.
Welcome to the Marvin Gaye Midnight Love Digital Tour. My name's Jamie Brown.
So just in case some of you don't know, I told Sasha if he had stayed in Belgium, he'd probably still be alive. Not long after he returned to the States, he had a hit with this song called Sexual Healing. He finally got, was it a Grammy that he had never earned with Motown? Pardon the explicit lyrics. You've heard this song. Your grandma, somebody played it, right? Okay. So, tragically, I'll never forget the day my family is going to the we call it the county fair. I don't know where they call it where you guys are from. And we're listening to the black radio station. We're in our Brady Bunch station wagon. And all of a sudden, the station goes dead. And the DJ comes on and he says, Marvin Gaye has just been shot by his father and he's dead. And it just colored the whole trip to the county fair. Like, who's going to be on an amusement park ride and not feel this is huge? And this may be a crude analogy, but in the same way that West Indians must leave Jamaica to come to England to do something to make their lives better, he's got to go to Belgium. And I guess I want you guys to think about it, and maybe Sasha can help us sort through, how does he become a hero there? How does he breathe again there? He says explicitly there's somewhere else he maybe wants to be, but he's here. He misses his mom. How many of you miss your family even though you're having a good time, right? This guy is in Belgium. Do you guys know where Belgium is? Tell us about Belgium, just real quick, Sasha.
Oostende, where he was, is a beach town near the border with Holland. It's pretty small, actually. Belgium is small, like Holland, you know, next to this 15 million people in both, 15 in the Netherlands, 15 in Belgium, roughly. And I mean, to the point, I mean, there's also the romanticizing of leaving the States for Europe. I also want to point out, I mean, it's not all roses over here either, you know. Obviously, like, yeah, the people from the Caribbean came to the UK, but there's a huge windrush controversy now. So, I mean, there's a lot of racism here. There were a lot of riots in the 60s with not only the Caribbean people, but including, like, all the Asian people that were here from the old colonies, like India and other countries in Asia. So I think the problems in the States have also been in Europe only a little later, because Europe kept Europe very white. I mean, we had our colonies over there. And then in America, of course, you know, the black people were in the territory. So that's what makes the history so different. But I think the racism was definitely the case in Belgium as well. I mean, the people that, you know, how I met Marvin Gaye, I mean, we would be in the car, and if you see, like, a car with black people in it, we would always be stopped. My whole car would be, like, or not my car, I was young enough, but the car I was in would be, like, you know, they would look if there's maybe some marijuana, or, like, you know, I mean, obviously we come from Holland, so.
You guys know Amsterdam is known, you can get the weed, right? Okay.
It's, so there's definitely that too. It's not like, oh, you know, now I'm in paradise. But it you know, it would be different still in that period of time, because there were not that many people that were non-authentic, or like first people European, that we call them that. Mm-hmm. The wording is another discussion, I think. How do you call people, right?
Yeah. Does anyone in here have any thoughts on why Europeans can just be Europeans, but you don't necessarily say Caucasian English or Caucasian Irish? You just say Irish.
It has been interesting, because in some of the articles I write, I would refer to it as, like, you know, if it's responding to an article, I would say, well, there's natives in Europe, and people were really shocked, like, how can you call them native? I'm like, well, I mean, that's what we are, if you sort of compare it. But the whole wording is an interesting discourse, I think, we need to talk. But it's also complicating things, where I'm like, okay, you know, like, every word needs to be weighted. It's, you know, it needs to be balanced a little bit, I think, in order to move forward also, and not, you know, keep polarizing because of words.
I hear you.
Focus on why this discussion.
Before we go outside, I promise you guys we're going to go right now. Who is this guy, Sasha, and why does he matter to what we've been discussing? Come on.
This is Michael McMillan. He's from St. Vincent and Grenadines. He's a professor in St. Martin in London, an art school. He's been living in London for most of his life. And I guess he's relevant because the first thing I'll be doing when I leave Oxford is make a stop in London and have a meeting, lunch with him.
She just leaves us to go to another Wikipedia person. what is he doing with the front room? What does that mean?
So this was it's a pretty known project of him that he's been exhibiting in different museums in the Tate, and it's been in the Brooklyn Museum in the States. And it sort of portrays this front room that is very Caribbean, and that all the Caribbean people also from the in the diaspora, sort of. You have like this sitting room or the living room, and it has the plastic couches, and everything is secured, and you sit there on Sunday, and otherwise you just live in the kitchen, and it's like all the things that mean something important to you are in the front room, and sort of that is what this portrays.
And it portrays aspiration, you know, respectability, politics. We want to be seen as more than the savage. But also, I think there's this story of belonging. We've been talking about that since day one. Family, home. Many of you come from homes where the front room nobody sits in. Yeah, it's another room that you kind of sit in. And this is for the guests who never come, or if they do come, they're in Winn-Dixie, right? Not Winn-Dixie. They're in the kitchen trying to get the food that you got from Winn-Dixie. Usually when I have a party, I'm like, why is everybody in the kitchen? Okay, so before we step outside and just breathe, or maybe breathe with a little project, I want to tell you that Sasha has, you know, offered not only a digital copy of her book, but a physical copy to anyone in this room. And I'm going to, since I don't have the little numbers, I'm going to just ask you, if you want this book, offer me a number between 1 and 59. I'm going to roll my timer, and wherever it lands, the closest number. So first of all, just throw out some numbers.
22.
Hold on. Let me roll first. Let me roll again. Okay, I rolled, because it went to 59, then it went to zero. So now it's at a number. Okay, now yell out a number.
30, 46, 47, 32, 15, 2, 12, 16.
Haley, give me a number. What'd you say?
20.
Haley, ooh, the book is yours. Because it was gonna be the 17 and the 23. We're gonna have to fight it out. So Haley, Sasha will sign this to Haley. And this will go to Gorgas Library for our permanent circulating collection. You guys rock. Don't worry, there'll be magpies tomorrow. I think I have two left. If anybody wants one, that's for me and John. Okay, Haley, this is yours. Let's go outside, you guys. I want to thank you all for coming on a day as hot as the one we have before us. Yeah, right? I want to sleep in here tonight. Totally. So thank you all just for just being here, period, with us in England. Someone sitting with me tonight. Yeah! Professor Smith, is this like the third time we tried to get here? One pandemic year, two pandemic years? Yeah, so we're really blessed. So y'all, let's take it all the way back safely. We're gonna be fine. So very quickly, I want to say, do we have a book?
Yes.
Yeah, so we have a book giveaway. I can't do the Oprah thing that I do in class where you get one, you get one, you get one, everybody gets one. But I will at some point, like, you just roll my timer and we're gonna find a number, and then that's the one. And whoever got the book earlier, no more books. Okay, so without further ado, I want to introduce you to my friend Sasha Dees, and we're going to have a conversation. In fact, I shouldn't be giving you her biography. She sent me her biography, but I feel like you're going to know more about her if you just, like, roll with it, okay? And I'm going to move over to Eleonora so you guys can sort of see us as best we can. We're both, I guess, into visuals, so it's probably darker than you really want it to be, but we need the lights up, we know how to make it happen. But Sasha, welcome to Whisper College, a Roll Tide welcome. And anyone who's had my class, you're well aware that she is going to push our thinking, but I think she's going to push everyone's thinking on so many issues involving how people come together in part historically with empire in view, right? But in your case, with the Caribbean and art in view. And you can tell I'm not used to using this. I'm going to trust that it works. Alexis is usually my tech person. Do I just, like, press this and it works, Alexis? Class. So again, biography. We're going to just flow with it. She is Dutch, but we learned today that she was actually raised in Belgium, which we
In Holland, but on the border.
On the border. In fact, that's a good opportunity to think through how borders are constructed spaces. So know that the reason why we're here is the publication. Well, all because we're here because we love each other. But she just had a book published that features 2 years of her research in the Caribbean, spending lots of time with artists. And you should know, she didn't just show up. She's been there for 20 years. Anyone who knows anything about ethnography, meaning interviewing people, getting them to trust you to tell their stories, they have to trust you.
Yes, they did. I mean, it was
can you guys hear her?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It was, where I grew up, there was a big society from the islands, from the Dutch islands, from Curaçao and Aruba. And so I really grew up with, in school, with some of the children of the parents that came to the Netherlands. And so that was also my first time that I went and was with a school friend, really. That's how long, really, I have been in the region, and after that I started working there as well.
Okay.
But yeah, that was really the start, really.
Okay, so this is a good time as any to just say, what do you do for a living? Like, do you just travel? Because I kind of feel like she just rolls wherever she wants to go.
Yeah.
What do you do? And some of my students already know.
There are these mornings that I wonder myself. But yeah, it really, I always wanted to travel, and I really found a way over some years. I mean, I worked as a freelancer in all kinds of jobs to make some money to pay my rent for a room and eat, as a typist, and like running around in a bunny outfit at a beach club, and you know, all kinds of jobs. And then next to it, I would work with artists. And in the beginning, that was musicians. And then the musicians made compositions for theater plays, and I started also working in theater. And it was like your age when I started, and so it was beginning musicians, and we were all trying to figure it out and learning that you need to build a CV in order to get into venues, in order to get funding, etc. And so that's really how that started. But for me, it became all these disciplines, dance, and then visual art. It was a time where it was I did a lot of hip hop music and jazz music, and theater was very experimental, interdisciplinary. So we would work with DJs, we would work with visual artists, we would make theater based on film. So it was from the beginning already working in all these disciplines. But I am not an artist, so I was always.
What are you?
A facilitator.
She is a facilitator. What is a facilitator? What is that all about?
Well, you facilitate creative people to work, to make their work happen in the best way possible. Find them platforms where they can present, or help them with what kind of contracts do you need to make, or try to figure out how to promote them, all the things to organize that they can do what they do best.
Okay.
That's basically it. Really.
So we're going to come back to some of the things that you've done, but I want to go ahead and show the entire group. One thing that you've done, I believe, is help people in the Caribbean sort of give voice to their own struggle, but also to their triumph, because we've been talking about how both things are important.
Yeah.
Not just sorrow songs, right?
Yeah, exactly. I think certainly in the Caribbean, it's way more about the joy, because it is their space much more than I think Black Americans feel is America is their space. So I think that is a difference, and I spoke to that a little bit this morning already, where I was saying, like, I think Black people in Europe too, in Holland, or I'm sure even in UK, the work is also a lot about wanting to have their space here, being taken for who they are, and wanting to have their identity. And being in the Caribbean, well, that is your identity. It's your country. It's, so that's, they don't need to fight for that. for them being there. Whereas,
meaning, when we say you're black, you're white, blah, 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 they're more, I am.
Yeah, I'm Caribbean. Or
consistently,
I am
from here,
found
that to be true.
And the even race matters much less than it does here. Or in the States, yeah. I'm sort of confused about Europe and Euro Americans, of course. But that is, you know, like you, and here, they enter the European space, or, you know, in America, there is, you know, there's the race issue. So, but if you're in your own country, I mean, I was, you know, we were talking about that. I mean, Chris Rock made this joke one time in one of his stand-up comedies that, okay, like Afro-Americans were sort of brought into America being stolen, but nobody claimed them back. And that's, you know, it was a joke, but it's, kids, it's a very painful joke. And because, you know, like, when is America really yours? Or like, you know, like, you can claim it, but if there's all these people around you that don't give you the same space as they have, then that's problematic. And in the Caribbean, that's different. Of course, there's also racism. Racism is everywhere in the world, but it's nowhere the way it is in America or in Europe.
That's your belief, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Because you've traveled a lot. I want to show you all just a few images. I posted this earlier this week online of art that you have in your book, people you've broken bread with, spent time with. I just want you to see how people in the Caribbean narrate themselves artistically.
Yeah.
And we're going to juxtapose it with some of the colonial postcards that students in music and race in the UK have seen.
Yeah.
Via the Bodmian website.
And this is a good work to show them, because it's very much, this is Onika Russell, it's a Jamaican artist who also teaches at Edna Manley Art University. And this work really speaks, all her work really speaks about how we from outside the Caribbean look at the Caribbean as a very exotic place, consuming the Caribbean in a way, whereas she lives there. It's also a place where people just live daily lives, like how we all do that. And it's not the notion of tropical paradise and exotic.
Mm-hmm.
That's what her work very much is about.
So we see words, clouds, is that salt water? We can't really see it clearly. But the thing is that you'll see very quickly how this is a counterpoint to some other images that are more disturbing. But before we go on, you said something about we consume the Caribbean. Can you share with them how people in the Caribbean move from one country to another, the difficulties they have? And it makes it so clear what imperialism has done even today, that you have to do what to go from one island to another?
Yeah, so when I traveled, I wanted to stay in the region, because most of the time it's easier to fly from an island to Miami or to back to Europe to go to an island that you can literally see over there.
Did you guys hear that? Is that crazy? You have to go back over to the Atlantic to go to another Caribbean island.
It is. I mean, it's cheaper.
Why is that so?
Because the airlines flying there mostly are still the European and American airlines who fly, and they really cater to us going there as tourists, and they don't cater to the people living there. And for a small island to start an airline by yourself that sort of connects to all these, that's financially hardly impossible. Plus, they try to do ferries, but then, like, all the major companies from America and Europe are basically sort of, blocking that, sort of trying not to have that too easy.
Mm-hmm.
So there is still, because they want, like, whoever flies on their flight. So there is still this this influence. And so, for instance, you fly from Curacao to Trinidad to Panama to go back to Jamaica or something, and it costs like $2,000, and it's basically an island that is maybe, I don't know, you could swim there.
And you share an anecdote.
And then you have to do the visas, because like Americans and Europeans, we have passports that from the 195 countries that the world has, we can fly without a visa to 186 of them. But if you come from Dominican Republic or Haiti or Jamaica, or, you know, like mostly the Republican islands,
mm-hmm.
then you all of a sudden need a visa. And it's not like a visa to go and work somewhere. It's a visa even if you want to come and visit me for a week. You need to pay, it's often like about $1,000, you need to show that you have a permanent job, you need to have somebody sponsoring you in the country where you visit, you need to have a family because we want to be reassured that you are not staying with us but you're going back. So there are all these things that you need to do. You need to have a bank account with enough money on it, and all of that you need to show to actually go on vacation for a week.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I would go there and be invited and stay with people and say, oh, you should come to Amsterdam, but that's impossible. And the thing is too, if I had to comply to all these rules to actually visit there, if I had to do that the same way coming into Holland for now, there would have been no way I would have ever traveled in my life ever. I never had a permanent job, I don't have a big fat bank account, I am not married with children. I mean, they wouldn't accept me then.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but they are, you know, my presence is never questioned because I'm a Dutch European, I have the passport, so they assume all is fine, apparently.
Share with them the anecdote about the one West Indian woman who challenged you and you were able to get on the plane. It's in the beginning of your book.
Oh, in Jamaica, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I flew, but another thing is that there are these attempts of smaller airlines from the islands to try and get that going. But often then, you know, they go out of business, so you buy a ticket, it's more affordable, and then the time comes you're flying, and then the airline is out of business, so they're
they don't even send you an email and say, you don't exist, here's your $200 back, you're just gone.
They're just bankrupt, so it's gone. So I would buy my tickets as late to the date as possible, and I would also fly one way because I would go from one island to another. But ever since 9/11, like some immigration is like have you that you have to actually show that you're also leaving. Where are you going after you enter? So I went to Jamaica. And I only had a flight going into Jamaica. So I get out of the line and I need to wait and like explain. And so there's all these people waiting. But then, you know, when she sees I'm doing this research and she's not really understanding like research to art, you know, who does that? And then, well, I guess she's European, like who pays for that? Like government pays for you to sort of... So there was a real, you know, all these questions. But in the end, she let me go anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, all the other people that didn't look like me and didn't have a European passport, they were put back on the planes back to where they came from.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of shows you, like, how being European or American, for that matter, still gives you so much privilege.
And she was a woman of African descent. She was a woman of African descent, right?
I mean, 95% of the people in Jamaica is black, so it's not them. And I came from Curacao, which is mostly black too, when I flew to Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
But still.
Can you tell them how it came to be that you did this book? And then we're going to get back to the art and juxtapose.
I think, you know, like in working there, it was everybody on the different islands where I would work would always say, you know, like it's so hard to get to another island, everybody's so isolated. It would be good to sort of know more of each other. But in that sense, like, you know, who has time and money to actually do that? And of course, me being from Holland, I could in the end apply for a grant at the Mondrian Fund, which is like something like the National Endowment of the Arts in the States. To then actually make this proposal and do this travel. And then I got the grant, which means you get 8 months, well, I got 8 months stipend to travel to 8 countries. And then eventually when I started traveling and everybody heard what I was doing, they became so enthusiastic that out of all these island people started approaching me, are you coming to my island? Like, I would like to invite you, if you can fly yourself over here, well, like, you know, you can stay with us and I can make you, bring you in contact with other people. And so I could sort of, by staying with people, I only rented a room in the first 2 months when I went to Haiti when I started. And after that, I was being hosted. Which meant I thought, okay, then I don't spend like all of my stipend. So I pushed it forward and kept traveling until the money was gone, which sort of brought me to like 16 months in 16 countries, basically. But that's with the sponsoring of all these people there who, you know, if you then go there, I'm like, I thought, okay, I'm so privileged, everybody think that I can take care of myself, so I'm welcome everywhere. But I'm visiting with people who are like, you know, successful artists in penthouses, and like, you know, they're like much better educated than me. And it really makes you aware of, I'll just being white apparently assumes all these things that I really didn't have, but Sharony, for instance, has, you know, I mean, so it's, yeah, I mean, and that kind of happens a lot, certainly, from all the, like, for instance, Haiti, with NGOs that working there, I stayed with a black curator, uh-huh. And he was working on a big project, and he said, like, oh, that was a chance for me to, through that, meet a lot of artists. And then, you know, like, he kind of used me in the end to sort of say, I would always wanted to do something in the Marriott Hotel, but they never want to talk to me. Would you mind, you know, like, making that meeting? And then I would just sit there, and there were, like, foundations that never want to make the meeting with him, but they would when I was there. And I don't even speak French. You know, I just sat there at the meeting, being a white person, I guess, you know, and that was enough for him to get the meeting. And that was really shocking to me. It was so blatant. I mean, that is, I think that is the institutional racism that we have, and certainly all these American and European foundations working in the region still operate like that. Way more blatant almost even than, you know, back home, really. Mm-hmm.
So it's your hope that this book will get into the hands of museums and curators, so you can expose some of the people you spent time with. I want us to take a look at some of these images. And by the way, you guys, I am a Mac person and absolutely going crazy with this PC. So hate to be an elitist. But look at how complex these images are. And this is just a fraction of what's in this lovely book that one of you will have. Did you say, how many countries in all?
16.
I don't know if you guys saw that image. That's after a hurricane. These are often, as I did with the flyers, I used what was around me. I was determined not to use a photocopy or anything. A lot of the artists are using things around them. This is a car destroyed during a hurricane, and someone made a picture when they saw the rainbow. I don't know if you can see that rainbow. It's absolutely stunning. You have lemons to make lemonade. It's called Car Hole Rainbow. Very interdisciplinary, as you said. Installations, paintings, photography, sculpture.
Yeah.
This one, I think the title has the word eye in it. Bad eyes. And you should know, earlier we asked Sasha which was her favorite island, and she couldn't come up with one. Can you tell us why again?
Yeah, because I think every island has its own reason why you want to be there. They're very, very different. It's sort of like, you know, the difference between Wyoming and New York, I guess. I mean, there is a difference, you know, it's just not the same. So there are reasons why you would want to be in one and other reasons why you would want to be in the other. And that's no difference in the Caribbean, I think.
We put Janet Jackson on the spot earlier.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if we'll do it again, but I played for the students this morning. What the heck? I love Janet. Everybody knows I love Janet. So on her Anita Joe album, released early this century before all the Justin, what's his name, Timber, yeah, problems. She had to meet a Joe. She had lots of interludes, like Solange has on her, I guess, her probably most popular album. And I wanted the students to hear Janet describe her favorite island. And I wanted to just sort of get us to think through, did I type that correctly? It will come up. Anita Joe. The complexities. Because I said to you, why would Janet Jackson like Anguilla? And you said what? What did you say, Sasha?
Because it's an island where obnoxious rich Americans
say that again?
Vacation a weekend per year.
And I was like, Janet seems to be a pretty aware person. You hear her talking about Anguilla. Let me pull it up. In fact, when she went to South Africa to do Got to What's Gone with Q-Tip, this was not too long after apartheid ended in theory, and she really talked about what it was like to meet South Africans. We were sort of thinking through this morning how oppressed people seem to be props in music videos. Even Beyonce has come under attack for sort of having Africans in the backdrop of her life.
Well, there is something weird about this whole, like, you help people. You know, it's in there with the hurricane things, but also in sort of doing good. I remember, for instance, like Russell Simmons started the Deaf Empowerment Fund, and it's he made these bracelets, and it has a small raw diamond in it. And then 25% of the profit would go to Botswana, where then the diamonds were coming from. And it was a collaboration with De Beers. And then, so I know I'm good friends with his older brother. So I was at a birthday, and he's there, like, oh, you know, he's doing all these good things in Botswana. And lots of people do that, and I think, you know, people mean well, but really, like, you make jewelry, and instead of just paying the right amount when you actually buy the diamonds to make the jewelry with, you actually exploit the people there. We all know that. The work, the way people need to work are terrible. They don't get paid enough. And then, you know, you make your money, and 20% of the profit, not even of the whole amount, then goes back there, and then you build a school, and you sort of stand there for the photos and see, look how good I did, and then the people need to thank you for that. I mean, that's kind of a weird construction to me. I don't know what you guys think about that, but I think something is really very wrong in how that works. And I think a lot of that happens also, like, in the region with the hurricane. Like Holland, for instance, is like Sint Maarten was totally destroyed. And then in our media it says, like, yeah, we're helping Sint Maarten, and we raise all that money, people raise it, and it goes like 70% of the Red Cross goes to their own organization, 30% goes to St. Martin, but it really doesn't. First it goes to Dutch organizations who are going to think about how to solve this problem. And then they're sending Dutch people there and Dutch construction people, and it's a Dutch company who's gonna rebuild the terminal that fell apart, that was already built by them in the beginning. To, you know, so I mean, they didn't do that very well to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
And then they loaned the money to build that new terminal for 3%, whereas Holland actually can loan money for 0%. So we're also making money of supposedly helping St. Martin.
But when we bring back in a musician like Janet Jackson and Michael, who, as a student, we said this morning, come out of this, like, you know, some of the traumas of people of African descent, make it around this bin. I mean, her father was a boxer, and then he was a steel worker.
But you become part of that system.
Exactly.
And I mean, I think we can question that, too.
Mm-hmm. Because even Michael is singing, they don't really care about us.
Yeah.
And I'm not putting Michael and Jack and Janet on the spot. I'm just saying, how do we escape that as artists? How we stop replicating some of these exploitive... Like, do we just not make art?
No, you can make art. But I mean, if you make money with art, then think about how to... I don't know the whole solution to immediately now, tomorrow, have a better world either. But I do think you need to be aware of what is it really that you're doing. And and using all the imagery of like poor kids in your videos, I mean, that is exploitive.
You saw Gorilla? I saw Island Light, but that's not it. It's not Island Light.
Wait. That one.
It's that's not it.
Yeah, it is. That's what you. That's what you did.
Keep going.
No, that's not it.
No.
And then again, I can't say enough. The Jacksons, and especially Michael, they donated like lots of money to oppressed people. I'm just talking about the images that circulate since we have art front and center. Yes, that's it. Listen to this. Can we get that?
Top
right.
I need Alexa something. I actually haven't seen this before. It's a YouTube short, so it's like YouTube version of Scream. I'm gonna go like
links to all kinds of museums, including the University of Cologne, where we found these disturbing images, basically turned the century to the mid-20th century. This is how same brown people are narrated. So if someone goes to Anguilla, sends a card back to the Metropole, these are the people I saw. Now this, of course, is disturbing. We know that. But some of it's actually pretty interesting, but how did they come up with, you know, alien looking, dark bodies, miscegenation, still dealing with this, mid-20th century. And the people that you spent time with, did any of them go in directions that feel like this?
No. Actually, there is an artist from Curacao who also curated shows and did a huge exhibition in
If you can dream it. Bye.
In the Tropenmuseum in Amsterdam, which is sort of the ethnographical museum, but that used to be part of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And with only imagery like that, it's called White on Black.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually also traveled to different countries, and so it sort of showed all these negrophilia.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they are sort of commenting on that, but then again, that happened then in Holland. And that was years ago, but didn't. I mean, you know, like, yeah, people talked about it, and then it sort of, you know, veered off again.
Mm-hmm.
This is Roof Garden. He's a very successful artist in Santo Domingo. Obviously, he has a penthouse with a roof garden.
So you had some swaggy lodgings.
And this is where, you know, we would like be if it's hot and have breakfast and stuff. So.
And where's where's this?
This is an exhibition in Santo Domingo. Also, it's some artists that just sort of graduated. And a curator who just did her PhD started this space and make exhibitions there and trying to like sell works of young artists. And so the woman is Alana Jackson, who is also an art historian and worked a lot. She did this program called Bebop.
Mm-hmm.
So she worked with Jeanette Ellers. It was also she also did work in the States.
Mm-hmm.
You might know, but she passed away actually.
Where are you here?
This is in Croatia. So during my trip, I met the director of the Museum of Fine Arts in Croatia during a residency program in New York called Art Omi. And they bring 35 international artists together from all over the world. And then there is a curator in residence, which was the director of that museum. And then they bring in all these people for 2 days. And then he heard that I was going to do this trip, so he asked me if I was interested then in making an exhibition where I, you know, maybe with Caribbean artists. So I proposed to do a dialogue between 7 artists from the Caribbean and 7 artists from Croatia. Sort of based on the fact that Croatia and Europe is also this, like, you know, tropical space, like lots of tourism. It has like also like the background of being, you know, like first part of the Soviet Union, and sort of all sort of being what used to be like second world, you know, like relatively having some money. And like, what are the issues that might be similarities? And I thought it was interesting because I was interested in bringing Caribbean artists to spaces other than, you know, the old colonizing countries.
Mm-hmm.
And Croatia doesn't have that link with the Caribbean at all.
Mm-hmm.
So this was the opening night, and so there are some of the artists from the Caribbean are visiting, amongst others, next to the guy with the blue shirt is Christophe Cogier from Trinidad. Next to him, Maxence Denise is from Haiti. And Christophe Cogier has a collective in Trinidad called Allesjaar, and that is part of Documenta now in Kassel in Germany.
So she just left Germany and she's heading back to a 100-day art exhibition.
It's like the largest art event really in the world, you know, like seen in like the Venice Biennale is more art market, but Documenta really is about the state of the art and its meaning really. So this is me again in Trinidad with Chris. This was during my research period and he was doing an exhibition, so I was sort of tagging along to look at how the work is being installed.
Mm-hmm.
But he's a very well-known artist that he studied in the States, actually, and he's represented by the gallery in the States and has been exhibiting everywhere, like all kind of biennials and stuff. And this is another exhibition also in Trinidad.
Trinidad.
Yeah, it has like also work by Peter Doig, who lives there now. So it's kind of interesting to see that all of a sudden there are these art stars all of a sudden living on an island, and then, you know, like work of them popping up like small works in like a local gallery, whereas like, you know, he's also hanging in a whole like, you know, like one of these big mansions in Venice, and then there he is in Trinidad. So that was
I want, if I may, as we prepare to open it up, and I want to ask you, we talked about this in our class, we've been sorting through how marginalized bodies actually embrace nationhood in really peculiar ways. I told my class that my mother came to a Alabama football game, national anthem, it's gonna be, you know, we're gonna sing it. And I was really curious as to how she would respond. Of course, she doesn't know who Kaepernick is. And it was like she put her shoulders back and like this, you know, like. And we have been addressing how you have to allow different generations to embrace who they think they are based on their particular experience. And so we may say, I'm woke because I do X, Y, Z. Someone else is sorting through it. But I want to go bring that in with, they also saw an excerpt from Girlhood, a movie about it, set in France, 2014. They know that Mariam has been physically abused by her brother, not sexually, but physically. But today he's happy. And I wanted to show like literally a 10-second clip, because I think it's kind of tragic that they're playing this video game and they so just don't even question the names of the teams they're embracing. They're embracing empire. And I wanted to ask you, have you seen any instances where you're like, it's really curious how the Barney that's marked oppressed does this? And so it's going to be the quick clip here, another quick clip, another one. We'll get back to that. See, oh, we're going to open it up, if that's okay. So, let me get this sound. I think we will.
On the zip.
He literally says, who do you want to be? And she's Brazil, and she says, no, France. And she's showing them that she beat up a girl. I want you to see the subtitles. Not Ghana, you know, not Senegal. I also want you to see this clip where you have, again, French girls, but they're really from the, ties to the continent. And it's interesting, they have this dance contest. And what do you see most prominent? The U.S. flag. These are poor girls. About empire?
No.
How do we consume this?
Is it on our mind? Earlier I told you guys, I don't wake up going, I'm black. I'm just Sharony.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, there's the marketing of American product and music and everything is so big, so.
And what do we do with Brazil? 1959, Black Orpheus, Carnival, even in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Empire is embraced.
Well, I don't know if Empire is embraced.
What's embraced? Tell me.
Yeah. It's, that if you see it, that's what you then think, but I don't think they think about Empire like you said.
Let's go forward. It's Carnival Day. This is a tragic film, by the way, you guys, so you don't want to watch it unless you're braced for it. But the dancing in it, we can get back to the dancing. Will we get back to the dancing? There we go. You don't think they put that on knowing that they look like, or trying to look like some British monarch?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's
curious. We're gonna stop there, you guys. Do you have any questions?
It's a difficult thing, eh? It's
yeah.
A complex thing. Mm-hmm. What do you guys think about that? Anybody?
They're tired, it's hot.
I'm happy to kick it off. Thank you so much for sharing so much personally and sharing so much professionally. And this talk was just incredibly generative. I wonder, I hope this is not an oversimplifying question, could you talk about the work of a contemporary curator? What that means on sort of like a global scale for fine art? I think a lot of folks wrongly assume curators are attached to a specific museum and are functionaries. Right, very busily taking care of a Monet,
yeah.
Right, very worried,
yeah.
And that is actually not what a fine art sort of curator, which has got an, like, is an artist in their own right. I wonder if you could speak about that a little bit.
Well, like myself, I just work as an independent curator, so I don't do anything, even I can be invited by a museum, but I'm not working there, so I don't get a salary. There's those jobs, and there are all these independent curators that come up with their own proposals, and then you find a location to, you know, like it, present that work. It could either be a project space where already art exhibitions are being done, or it could be, you know, a space where that even is not happening and you just make that happen, for instance. So it's really almost being your own sort of small company. You have to like find the money and get a location and do all the organization around that as well. So that happens a lot with emerging artists, you know, and then when they start to go to a museum, then like more established locations pick it up. And then still, like, you can always be an independent, sort of even being hired as an independent to do bigger art exhibitions like, you know, a Biennale, or you don't necessarily need to be coming from a museum nowadays anymore. So there's lots of people working independently in that sense. Is that?
Yeah, I just think, like, could you talk about how that's an artistic mode? Like that is real artistic labor, and there are ways in which you might envision that. I'm making big assumptions. Like, right, what's the artistic work behind being a curator that is not just being hot with a phone and good with email?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, it's basically also telling a story. You start with having an idea about something, a story that I want to tell, and then, or an issue that I want to speak of, and then which artists, you know, go with, like, really have the language around the story that I want to sort of convey. So in that part, I think it is artistic. And also, you need to find artwork that sort of strengthen each other. And you hope you're successful in that are in dialogue with each other. So when you you know, you could see one work by itself, but if you see it next to another work, all of a sudden it says something extra because it's in dialogue with another work. So that's more the artistic side of it, I think. I mean, there is a lot of, you know, a lot of business and calling and all of that. But I think in the end, it's about the storytelling, really.
Interesting. Anyone else? Yes.
Like I said, like because I grew up already with some friends from the islands, for me it was very naturally. I didn't even really think about it in that way. You know, not that, I mean, you know, there is this expression like, I don't see color, which I don't believe in. I mean, you know, I did see color. This is why I also went with them to the island, because I was curious to what do they bring that I don't know about. But it was very organic, so you know, when I started working, that was automatically with my friends, and they were already diverse before we even called that diverse. So it wasn't really a choice, you know, like, oh, this is my choice of area, like how you would do that in an academic career. I just sort of was facilitating my friends, and they just happened to, you know, like lots of them came from that region. So then, you know, the work sort of naturally followed, like, oh, let's go, you know, like they live in Holland, let's go and do concerts back in Suriname or on Curaçao. And, because that's, you know, that's an easy way to start, so that's how that would start, and then it would sort of grow from that, like one thing rolls into another. I was saying to Sharony, for me, when the first time somebody built a website for me, and then all kind of stuff went on that, and I was looking at this website, I'm like, oh my God, you know, this person really had like this plan of a career, and it wasn't like that at all, you know. Sort of looking back, all of a sudden it looks like it's sort of building somewhere, but I just sort of I didn't have that plan at all. I started, for instance, with Sharony, and then I met somebody else with Sharony, and that sort of did that project, and then I met another person, and I, you know, the person who was saying like, oh, I would like to do this, and I'm like, that's a great idea, let's do that, and then we'll do. So it was a very organic way of starting the career, and it built this large international network that, you know, like people sort of, you know, do things for me, I do things for them, because, you know, at first you don't have no money, so you find other ways of doing things. For instance, you can travel and you can sort of try to get funding to now, like, book a hotel and stay there, or you can just call somebody that you know, and if you can, you know, can I stay in your guest room and do that? So I always tell people that's sort of how we started, like, what is it that we ultimately want? We want to go there. Okay, so getting money to go there is one way, but you could also look around and think, do you have a car? Can you maybe drive me halfway? And then is that, you know, like do it in different ways. And that's sort of how that started. And because you then sort of do it so much together, all these people, this is like, you know, I mean, we met 20 years ago, then, you know, she...
Tell them how you found me again. My students know, because I didn't remember how she found me again.
And, you know, we sort of fell out of touch because she left and I didn't know where she was, and it was sort of pre-social media, so it wasn't that easy to stay in contact. And then
I can't believe it.
I was in LA with an animator, and he has a big art collection, and he was showing me all the works. And then there was this one work, I'm like, oh, is that Sharony? Because I had seen her work at the time, and there was sort of that engine. He's like, I don't know, I got this was a gift from New Orleans. And I'm like, I'm sure it's Sharony Green. And he's like, oh, can you introduce me then? So I said, I don't know where she went. I have to look it up, but hey, now
she went to school to be a teacher.
Now we have social media, so I'm like looking, and I found her, and then I sort of connect them together as well. And then we got back in touch. But so for me, like, I think my largest capital is people. So this trip in the Caribbean also was because I knew so many people. And not only work, it's not like a work relationship, it's really friendships also. Mm-hmm. So there is intimacy in that way, you know, like it's... And I think that is also why when people help you a lot. I was like amazed, but then, you know, when I lived in New York, like everybody would always call me like, oh, you know, my friend is stranded in Newark, you know, are you in, can she stay with you? Sure. You know, and then this person comes and I'm like having an air mattress or whatever. It's not that I live that day, but everybody's always welcome. Mm-hmm. And somehow that also translates in what I do, and it's not always like I do something from Sharony, so now Sharony needs to do something back because that's an agreement.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really, you know, like, you just do it.
Right.
And then
we have Emily, anyone else? Emily?
Yeah, it's you too, I think. Mm-hmm.
I have the opportunity to visit St. Martin over spring break, and I noticed some discrepancies between the French and the Dutch side of the island. When you visited, when you were looking at the various artists and their work, did you notice any things that kind of ran through all of the artists' work, or specifically there, were there major differences on either side?
Between the sides? There is actually not that many artists on the Dutch side. And I think that is also, you know, there's a known artist from the Dutch side, but she's actually, she makes all her work there, but she teaches in New Jersey, actually. So she lives in the States most of the time. There are far more artists on the French side, but a lot of them actually are from France. And so they sort of, you know, like, live in St. Martin, which is, you know, a lot warmer and nicer than being in France, and that sort of, so you have a lot of that, I found, which you don't find really in on the Dutch side. So there were like two young people on the Dutch side when I came, who just sort of graduated and really wanted to come back to the islands, which you see more often now, on all the islands actually, and then the hurricane came. So for St. Martin, for me, it was also difficult to see the work because a lot of it was destroyed. So a lot of the artists lost their studios, and they lost their work. There was this one artist who the only thing she had left was work that actually was in an exhibition outside of the island. And everything else was, I mean, you know, it was just ruined, and then it rains always after. So. So that was pretty devastating, really. So it was that was difficult because the period that I went there was a difficult one. But those are some of the differences. And then there is a lot of decorative work because that's what tourists want, right? So there are artists that do their autonomous work for themselves. And then they sort of make money with maybe commercial photography, you know, like the colorful palm trees, blah, 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 that people associate. Which is actually interesting because palm trees are imported.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not even really from them.
If I may, I'd like to close with a reminder, especially to history majors, but to everyone, because we're all historians, as Dr. Buehler likes to say. The archive is important. I had an experience with Sasha where I told her how my family on my dad's side, paternal side, are from
the Bahamas. And while we were in London our first month here, I went into the into Kew Library, where the archives are here in England. Well, there are many, but this is the National Archives, like the National Archives. I asked her if she went to Eleuthera Island in the Bahamas, and she said Spanish Wells. And I told her that I had just read these colonial office reports during the First World War. Well, they described the Bahamian people, the black Bahamians, as the most orderly, well-dressed, educated, yada, yada, all these superlatives, as if it's an honor to be all these things and be colonized. And therefore, they're not sending them to the front line with the people in Kingston. Maybe we'll spare 25. But Spanish Wells had 700 white settlers who were determined to keep Spanish Wells white. And my family came from Savannah Sound Settlement, where there's no more than 600 blacks. Unlike the people in Jamaica, they headed east to Miami, sometimes to Key West, but by the First World War to Miami, and by, of course, post-war period, a lot of West Indians are heading to Great Britain. I share all that to say I wouldn't have been able to say to her when she said she went to Spanish Wells, that little small detail that makes me now wonder if I decide to spend the next 10 years of my life recovering this part of my family's life, not just for genealogy's sake, but maybe for the historical record in a published way, that I just wanted to say I'm grateful to you for just being with us and bringing the Caribbean closer. And
a little bit
closer. And I won't, you know, we're all tired. I won't show you this video, but just know that Lenny spent most of the pandemic in Eleuthera. It's a very small place, pink sand. Go to Miami right now and someone says they're Bahamian. How is it that they will, without question, mention Eleuthera, and some of them will mention Savannah Sound that had no more than 500 people in 1915, 16, 17? Have a very rich person, you know, oh, like Anguilla, the islands. You know, $1 million jacket in the ocean. And yet, the tragedy is still there in the backdrop. And that's just how, you know, messy our shared complex past is. And I'm not putting Lenny on the spot in the same way that I wasn't putting Michael and Janet, although they are part of a difficult narrative too.
First move to The Hague, which is like the political capital, right? And then to Amsterdam. And then I moved my life as a little way for it, but became New York and Amsterdam, and traveled from those two cities to other places, so Africa, Caribbean, Asia.
Wow.
Yeah.
And I've only been to the north of Belgium. We were trying to do an Amsterdam thing, but it was just kind of too far for a weekend trip.
Yeah.
But I really want to go
there. You could take the Eurostar, and there's like a direct train. If two times a day, so you have to time it out, but then it's only 3 hours actually, the train from London, it goes straight into Amsterdam. It stops in Brussels and I think Antwerp and Rotterdam.
Yeah, I've only been to Bruges and Ghent.
Yeah. So Ghent actually is 50 minutes away from where I grew up.
Okay, yeah. No, I love Bruges because it's like medieval Disneyland almost. There's like no cars, it's just like chocolate and french fries and like, who's the artist? The big artist.
Van Gogh?
Rubens. No, it's the painting of the woman in black and the woman in green. It'll come to me eventually. He's Flemish.
Yeah, there's a Flemish school of like how you have Rembrandt in the Netherlands, you have Bruegel in
Van Eyck. Yeah. And they tell you all his story when you go there.
Francis!
So, hold on.
Excuse me.
So since like clearly the Caribbean is a very different climate from what you grew up in Belgium, do you think that the climate had any different effect on like, maybe not directly, but on the type of art people made when you were in the Caribbean versus when you were in Belgium?
I do actually. I think because it's about light, really. So the light sort of makes for different colors. And so what you see here is different when you would see it in the light over there. So then
obviously what you would paint or the colors you would use are different than. So a good example, for instance, is Chris Ofili, who's a British American artist from Nigeria. That do you guys know him? And so he went and lived in Trinidad now. And then his next series that he did for the museum in New York, you see like how his colors are totally changed. And it sort of made even more sense to me when I saw a Dutch person going to Trinidad on a residency, and she made a whole new series, and the coloring was actually the same. I can show you pictures, or I can send them to Sharony so she can share them. So colors and light, you know, which affects colors, is definitely different because of, yeah, climate. Yeah.
Alexis and Gabriel.
I was going to ask, like, you said you were an organized person. That's something that you do. What was the process like of keeping track of all the artists in your book and, like, going about getting permission to publish it?
Yeah.
And did you face any resistance from anybody?
No, not really resistance, which was, which was great. But I guess that also comes from me spending so much time there. And, you know, like, so I had already a group of friends there that, you know, people that I had worked with over the 20 years. And then those sort of informally introduced me to other people, because I had at first approached people like museum directors and other artists, and, you know, you don't hear anything back from an email because, hell, they don't know who you are, so they're not responding. But then if you start using, you know, you ask somebody, like, can you introduce me? Then all of a sudden doors go open, because, I mean, now the person recognizes the email. You know, there is trust because this person is actually asking them to, you know, receive me and have an interview with me. And that's kind of how that worked. I think without them, that would have never happened. So I had no idea how to do research. I mean, I actually didn't study, so I didn't learn how to do that in school either. So I actually just said that, oh, I'll meet with everybody that wants to meet me with. So in the end, I met 866 people that I spent lots of time with, and like every conversation was 4 hours. So I have over 3,000 hours on the recording, which is a total mess to then make a book of, because that's way too much. And also the conversations were very informal. So listening back to it, I'm like listening to my own self for half of the time, because we are actually in a conversation. Somewhere in there are the questions that I wanted the answers to. So I had to make a selection in the book, like who represents a specific thing that, you know, sort of stroked me that I wanted to be in the book. And then I showed all of the quotations, because there's lots of them. You know, you travel with me, then I meet you, and you say this, and then I send that part with an intro and an extra, like, okay, this is how you will be in the book. It's your voice. You know, let me know if this is okay. If you want to change anything, you can. So everybody had, because it's their voice, I really wanted them to. And so I think two changed something, and the rest was sort of, you know, like minor things. And then the pictures in it, I mean, I know how slow everybody always is. I mean, that I learned over the years, to get information from artists is a pain in the ass. So I knew that I wanted to have pictures. So I started, but when I started writing, I already made like the contract and started sending this out, like, I would like to have a photo of from your practice in my book. They all could choose their own photo they wanted to be represented with. And some of them sent a specific photo. Some said, oh, you know, you choose, or I send you 10 and you choose. And then they all signed up for it, that I could use it for the book and everything around the book.
Can I ask you, what do you hope will happen to the book? You want museums to have this book. Why? And then we're going to go to Gabriel and wrap it up, unless someone has another question.
Well, I, you know, for me, since I've been working in this for so long, I wanted to really sort of share my knowledge, because the whole discussion, certainly nowadays with all the decolonization, etc., museums are more open for items from outside. And then they are like, well, but we don't know where they are. So here is a book.
Now you do.
And it actually gives the names, the emails, the websites. You can call me. Mine is in it. There's museums. You can invite curators to actually have a Caribbean perspective instead of me making an exhibition. So I'm also trying, you know, they asked me to make an exhibition, and then I'm like, well, if you really want the voice of the region, you should maybe ask one of the curators mentioned in the book, because they're from there. And because it's easy to become an expert on the region now, everybody's like, oh, you're the expert on the region, but I just know what they told me, and they know more. You know, I'm like this one eye in the land of blind people, you know, but there's also people who have both eyes. Maybe we should ask them, you know.
And it goes back to what I was trying to do with the pictures, how I see me versus how I'm seen.
Yeah, yes. And then I think it could also be interesting, you know, to make exhibitions pointing out what I was talking about, like what is the difference between being in the region all your life and working there, or from the region but being here, you know, like, and how is that different? And because that also then can translate to, okay, so now if you're a European or you're an American, if this takes place in the States, like, how does that relate? Like, some of the Caribbean artists might actually have more with you in common than with the artist in the Caribbean.